Olá, meus amigos, bem-vindos a mais uma edição do programa Os Portugueses no Val, que está na vossa companhia há praticamente 29 anos e sempre ao serviço da comunidade de língua e cultura portuguesas e da comunidade de origem portuguesa, que poderá não falar, portanto, em português, é o caso da maioria dos lusodescendentes já de segundas, terceiras e sucessivas gerações, mas que ainda continuam ligados à nossa cultura, às nossas tradições e ao entusiasmo de ter a continuidade da presença portuguesa, das nossas vivências portuguesas e luso-americanas aqui em terras da Califórnia, mais concretamente aqui no Vale de São Joaquim. E o nosso programa de hoje será um programa também um bocado diferente. Estamos tentando trazer aqui ao programa Os Portugueses no Vale, vozes diferentes, programas diferentes e sempre falando das nossas vivências aqui no Vale, a nossa presença portuguesa e a nossa presença de luso-americanos. Hoje vamos estar em casa de uma amiga nossa que durante muitos anos apresentou e continuará a apresentar no futuro aqui no programa Os Portugueses no Vale, a minha amiga doutora Lúcia Noia, que na sua casa foi anfitriã para um acontecimento extremamente importante na nossa vida de comunidades portuguesas aqui no centro da Califórnia. Portanto, em casa da professora Lúcia Noia, doutora Lúcia Noia, melhor dito, ela também professora, ela tem uma credencial para ensinar para o resto da vida nas escolas, portanto, na universidade, nos community colleges. Mas a doutora Lúcia Noia, que aqui apresentou comigo o programa Os Portugueses no Val, e espero que ela volte em breve, a Lúcia, portanto, generosa como sempre, recebeu numa das suas casas aqui na cidade de Fresno um grupo de pessoas ligadas, portanto, a duas instituições. Teve, portanto, uma missão dupla. Falar, portanto, de toda a atividade que está a acontecer na Universidade Estadual da Califórnia em Fresno. Como sabem, esta universidade aqui no centro da Califórnia tem de facto uma vida muito dinâmica. É considerada a 17ª universidade mais bem classificada entre todas as universidades. E relembro aos nossos amigos telespectadores que existem milhares, literalmente mais de 1000 universidades, milhares aliás, de universidades nos Estados da América. Fresno State está, como assim é popularmente conhecida, a Universidade Estadual da Califórnia em Fresno está em 17ª posição. E em casa da Lúcia tivemos a presença de dois dos responsáveis da administração da universidade, o diretor da Faculdade das Humanidades, o professor Dr. Saúl, que é, portanto, também falante de português, e para além disso o Saúl, portanto, é ainda uma pessoa muito ligada à nossa comunidade, estudou português em Portugal, tem um doutoramento que, portanto, tem a ver com a nossa literatura portuguesa, e o professor Dr. Saúl Jiménez Sandoval, que é o diretor da Faculdade das Humanidades, e a professora doutora Sandra Whitty, que é, portanto, a diretora da Faculdade da Agricultura, das Ciências Agrárias e Tecnologia. Vamos, portanto, apresentar-vos isso hoje aqui no Canal 49, o testemunho deles, que eles falaram sobre o que está a acontecer, o que tem acontecido e vai acontecer no futuro naquela universidade, porque tem a ver com todos nós e precisa de facto do apoio da nossa comunidade. É tempo, chegou o momento, é uma altura histórica para que nós estejamos presentes na Universidade Estadual da Califórnia em Fresno, não só com uma aula, mas com muitas aulas de língua e cultura portuguesas e também aulas que tenham a ver com a identidade portuguesa, com a presença portuguesa aqui na Califórnia, nos Estados Unidos e no mundo, nas outras faculdades, na Faculdade de Ciências Sociais, na Faculdade das Ciências Agrárias e Tecnologia, portanto, obviamente, na Faculdade das Humanidades e não só. O nosso programa, Os Portugueses no Vale, hoje, graças, portanto, à California Portuguese American Coalition, CPAC, graças também à nossa amiga doutora Lúcia Noia, portanto, apresentando-vos alguns momentos em casa dela, numa das casas dela, sobre tudo o que está a acontecer e vai acontecer, novidades espetaculares na Universidade Estadual da Califórnia, em Fresno. A apresentação, obviamente, que é em inglês, mas eu penso que todos entenderão que são momentos históricos nesta universidade, mas mais importante ainda, são momentos históricos para a comunidade de origem portuguesa no centro da Califórnia. O programa Os Portugueses no Val esteve presente e tudo isto graças também ao apoio da Fundação Luso-Americana para o Desenvolvimento. A FLAD esteve presente, o seu presidente, o professor Dr. Vasco Rato, também falou e, portanto, vamos hoje apresentar a primeira parte de dois programas dedicados a estes acontecimentos que têm a ver com a FLAD, com o Fresno State e com a nossa comunidade.
Ok, no futuro da língua portuguesa em Fresno State é um futuro brilhante, é um futuro que é muito prometedor. Nós temos uma professora em português agora, a primeira professora em português na toda a história de Fresno State. Temos também o Denis Borges, que está a ensinar português com nós. E estamos a ter um momento decisivo, porque temos agora um momento preciso para poder formar, para poder envisionar um centro onde todos vamos a compartilhar de nossas ideias para engrandecer a língua portuguesa e a cultura portuguesa também. Temos uma comunidade muito forte no Vale e, por isso, temos uma conexão com o continente velho, com os Açores, com Portugal, e somos uma parte decisiva neste Vale também. Então, por isso, tenho muitas esperanças para o futuro da língua portuguesa e para a cultura e para a história, a ciência política, tudo o que compreende o mundo lusófono.
E é algo novo que não tenha acontecido no passado, no Fresno State. Não, portanto, é uma novidade total, porque nada disto aconteceu no passado.
Nunca antes tínhamos tido esta oportunidade e este apoio do presidente. Não? Temos um presidente que está a envisionar connosco um futuro forte em português e um futuro que forma uma parte fundamental do ADN cultural do Vale, não?
When I spoke to Lucia a few months ago about doing this little get together, the idea is basically it came to fruition because of two things. First of all, something that is happening at and has been happening at Fresno State, California State University of Fresno, for the last 2 years and will continue hopefully for many years. That will be the first part of our program. And our second part will be about the California Portuguese American Coalition, CPAC, and the work that we're trying to do there and to try to explain that to you a little bit. What is CPAC? It's not the national CPAC. We're an organization that I'll take just a few minutes to explain to you why we're doing what we're doing. So, and first and foremost, to start off the part about Fresno State, there's some of you have followed either social media or even the regular media, or Miguel. Yes, or Miguel, who is the social media king. You can go ahead and certainly see that there's some interesting things that have happened this week at Fresno State. But they have been happening for a while, okay? It's not something that just happened Monday. What happened Monday is, let's say, the continuation of something that was started a couple of years ago. And so to talk a little bit about that, I would like to introduce you the Dean of the Department of Agriculture, the College of Agriculture and Science, and our good friend, Dean Sandra Whitty.
2.5 years ago, close to three now, we started conversations with the Tulare Angra Sister City Foundation. And how could we connect Fresno State in the heart of the most important agricultural region in the world with the University of the Azores and the Angra campus that also was teaching students about agriculture? And through many talks and many get-togethers, about 6 months later, we started that relationship. I traveled along with some of my colleagues to the University of the Azores on Treseda, and we started talking about how this would work. Meanwhile, we applied to the Luso-American Development Foundation, FLAD, and let them know about what we would like to do and how we plan to do it, which included students traveling both from Fresno State to the Azores and from the Azores to Fresno State. We were very fortunate and grateful to receive a gift from FLAD that started us at $49,000. That was matched by a local Azorean, Helder Dominguez. And also we did had the honor of having fundraisers with the Tulare Angra Sister City Foundation. By the way, January 26, 2019 is the soup supper. Don't miss it. You will not want to miss it. And all of that came together, and we have now had two summers, in which students from the Azores have traveled to Fresno State, and students from Fresno State have traveled to the Azores. The first year, we did a travel tour experience where our students visited over in the Azores, many of the agricultural industries over there. The students that came to Fresno had the same experience here in the Central Valley, including going up to Sacramento and meeting with some of our legislators. The second year, we decided to do a little more intensive program, and we had three students that traveled from Fresno to the Azores to do 1-month-long internships in research related to agriculture on the Terceda campus. And at the same time, we had three students that came from the University of the Azores to Fresno State and worked with our animal sciences faculty on research on our farm. It's been highly successful, and we're very happy to say that we're now in the planning stages for the third year of exchanges for students. But as Denise said, we have a new development, and we are moving forward in the development of the Portuguese Beyond Borders Institute at Fresno State that will be a comprehensive program that we will be developing along with Dean Saul Jimenez Sandoval in the College of Arts and Humanities and Dean Michelle Bendesti in the College of Social Science to get started, and it will be a comprehensive program that recognizes the role that the Portuguese immigrants have played in California and all the rich heritage that will be preserved through the work that we have to do.
It has taken me half my life to be here with you. It takes a lot of people to build something together. When people believe in something, they come together, they put their resources together, and then they build a community. And this is what we are. We are a community of people who are interested in Portugal. We're interested in the Azores, and we're interested more than anything in the legacy that the Portuguese have had since the 14th century, right? Since forever, you have been the nation of seafarers that have gone throughout the world, that have brought the world together. And now you are here in the Central Valley with very deep roots in this very fertile land that now sees the community come together and constructing something that is really worthwhile. Portuguese with Beyond Borders, which is the brainchild of Dinesh and also of my dear friend Sandra Witte, and with the help of Alcidia, is that institute at Fresno State that is going to bring everything together that deals with Portugal. It's everything together that starts with a nation that had to fight against a very powerful neighbor throughout its existence, right? And had to say to itself, we are Portuguese, and we are always going to be Portuguese. No, we are not going to speak Castilian. No, we are not going to speak Galician. We're not going to speak Leonese, right? We are going to speak our language, and we are going to continue our traditions. And within that, I really like to thank a lot of people. But first and foremost, I'd like to thank the partnership that we've had with Sandra Witte, the Dean of Jordan College of Agricultural at Fresno State, with Alcidia as well. Together with their partnership, we were able then to connect with Dr. Vasco Ratu. He has been integral in all of this. With the money that we are receiving from FLAD, we are then going to establish the lecture series that is going to have two components. The first component is the local component of people here in the valley, these Portuguese Americans that have made this their home, that are going to then teach us what has gone through their lives. What wisdom do they have to give to us? What pearls of wisdom are we going to then learn from them? And how are they going to connect to our younger Portuguese Americans who do not have the experience of the direct connection to Portugal, right? And then the second component of the lecture series then, of course, is the international aspect of it, right? To bring international, world-renowned scholars on politics, on economics, on culture, on art, and to speak about the sense of being Portuguese in the world. That's really important, right? The sense of self-knowledge is the most important. It's the most important base that somebody can have. If you know yourself, you then have the doors open before you. And within that, we need to contextualize the Portuguese in the valley within the world, right? The legacy of the Portuguese is really, truly incredible. And this is coming from somebody who is not Portuguese. I studied in Portugal, and when I was there in 1994, it changed my life forever, as you can tell. So within that, I'd like to also thank Lucia Noia for being that angel that always comes and rescues us, you know, and gives us and inspires us continuously with her love of culture, her love of Portugal. I also want to talk to you about the second component, which is a really critical component, which is the oral history project that Portuguese Beyond Borders has. The oral history project then is going to bring a repository of knowledge from you sitting here, right? What do you want to say to your kids? What do you want to say to your grandkids? What do you want to say to the future generations of Portuguese Americans about what you had to endure in the 1960s when you came to the U.S., the 1970s when you were working at the Leiterias, right? When you were dealing with the vacas and everything else, right? What is the value of work, and where did that work lead you to? What can you teach? What can you leave? What legacy are you going to leave then the future generations through this? And this repository of knowledge is going to be stored at Fresno State. So based on this, I'm truly honored. This is a historical moment for me. I see this, you know, 20 years from now, people are going to say, and then they met at the house of Lucia Noia, and then it happened, right? And then Dr. Hatu came, and then it happened, right? And then Miguel Vaz, you know, came, and then it happened, yeah. Right? So everything is coming together. I'd like to also thank Dr. Castro. He is a staunch supporter of Portuguese studies, of Portuguese Beyond Borders, right? I'd like to thank Debbie, who has always been there. She and I have been friends since 1992, a long time, right? And I'd like to thank Inesh as well. Because when she came here and she interviewed with us, she saw the beauty of the valley, and she saw the beauty of this community. And that's really what it takes. It takes a community to really build something as great as this. So thank you all for being here. Thank you, Denise, for all that you do. And thank you for all that, all the energy and soul and heart that you put into all things related to Portugal.
So there's lots of interesting things happening at Fresno State, and hopefully you'll all be part of it. Dr. Castro mentioned in the presentation on Monday that his vision is that Fresno State will be the hub for all things Portuguese in not just the Valley, but also throughout the state of California.
We all share a commonality of interests. But for those of us who are Americans of Portuguese descent, we have a passion for our Portuguese roots. I can't say it any more simpler, but more passionate than that. I mean, it's in the coração, no? You know, it we feel it. It's a part of who we are. Whether we trace our roots from the Azores. By the way, Portuguese ambassadors to the United States have gotten pretty much conditioned now to, when they meet the Portuguese delegation in Washington, to hear, usually as the first question, well, how are everything in the Azores? Because we have a presence, but a bit of a Azorean-centric notion. And of course, the first ambassador said, well, you know, I mean, the Azores are just a small part of Portugal, you know, I mean, but it's an important part of our ancestry. It's an important part of Portugal because it's a nation, as was noted before, of seafarers, but it is a nation that was one of the first two superpowers in the world back in the 15th and 16th century. And it has the second oldest diplomatic relationship with the United States, the second nation to recognize the United States. And so this bond that we share is a very strong bond. And it's one that I think many of us want to enhance. And so this effort that Denise Borges has put together with the board that is here today, that is now further enhanced by FLOG, the Luso-American Institute that I've gotten to know over the years. And under its leadership with Mimiga Vasco Otto and Miguel, who is always forever there, is truly something that we need to focus on. And so I want to commit, because talk is easy, but, you know, it's the follow-through that counts in these things. I want to commit to our group here locally and the board of directors that are here that I will be a part of any fundraising effort that we put together. And I'll do it with my own personal support, and I know a few people. I'm not the best fundraiser. I'm not the worst. I'm somewhere in the middle. But let's get to work on this, because I have been bugging Vasco for several years now about a West Coast presence. We have a strong Portuguese communities both on the East Coast and the West Coast. But the East Coast, traditionally, for a lot of reasons that make sense, has gotten the focus, and that's fine. But I remind my friends, my colleagues, when FLOG hosts this annual meeting in Lisboa, that, we have a strong, strong Portuguese presence that is rich in history and tradition in California. And 80% of it, of course, is Azorean, and it goes back to the middle of the 19th century. Many of you have read Al Graves' book about the Portuguese in California that really depicts a lot of that diaspora. And, you know, when we think about small islands of those who cast their fate not only to the wind but to the sea, and dominated by fishing industry and dairy, and the fishermen settled on the East Coast and in places like San Diego and San Pedro, and the dairy folks settled in places like Norwalk and Cerritos, and here in the San Joaquin Valley and Tulare, and Carmen's father, a lot of families here, obviously, and Merced and Gustin, as we pronounce it properly, and all of the wonderful towns in between, and the Festus Britsants are all a part of that rich tradition and history that we enjoy. As a matter of fact, mi amigo Manuel Vieira, who you mentioned a moment ago, is having his Festus. Some of us will be at it on Sunday. And he gives back, like you give back, Lucia. So we need to tap those people who have had a tradition of giving back. And I mean, it's the Portuguese way, right? I mean, whether you're here or whether you're in Portugal, those of us who have come to this wonderful country are made up of a nation of immigrants past and immigrants present. And if you want to, in my view, trace the greatness of America, it's the story of the immigrant. The story of the immigrant who came here with not much but the clothes on their back, with a strong sense of family, an incredible work ethic, and a desire to see that their children had a better life than they had. I mean, I must tell you that when my grandfather, Jeviva Costa, came in 1897 from a small freguesia in Terceira, a freguesia de Raming, he left going to pasture to tend to the cows, but that's what he told his mother and father. But he and a friend had a plan, and they didn't. He didn't go to the pasture. He went to the harbor of Angra do Heroísmo, and got on a boat, a ship. All he had was an address that had a brother that was milking cows in Hanford, California. Or as the greenhorns would say, on foot, right? That's how they pronounced Hanford. And how a 15-year-old kid, I mean, there was no Google, there was no internet. My four grandparents were non-English speaking, and three of them were illiterate their entire lives. Their entire lives. You talk about risk-taking. I mean, we all admire risk-takers in our country and throughout the world. But I mean, I can't imagine how he would, at 15 years of age. I mean, I was learning to tie my shoes at 15. And to come there and get on, and end up in Fresno, California. And, you know, it wasn't like he got on his cell phone and he said, you know, to his brother, you know, Frank, he says, you know, I'm here in Fresno, come pick me up. Hell, there was no cell phones. There was no telephones. But he had this address. And he made someone explain to him this address, how to get to Hanford, California.
Thank you very much for gathering here tonight. It was a pleasure and an honor to have some of you here, all of you. And it was very emotional to listen to you, to the story of the ancestors. I have heard those stories several times. Your mother used to talk about that. It was very emotional to see that so many people that I knew as youngsters now occupy places of high pluses in our society, in our social structure. I want to thank you very much, and we are going to have some dessert. Fatima, it's true. What you see here was not my work. I just said I need to put together a dinner. And it happened. So I came here yesterday. Everything was done. And that's my involvement. But believe me, I made a lot of phone calls. But that's about. Thank you, Dennis, for putting all of this together. It was a wonderful evening, and I hope that we will meet again. Thank you very much. And I want to thank Fatima Parreira, Gabriela Dias, Irene. Did she leave already? Oh, she's in the kitchen. Oh, for the dessert. Irene, she is so good. And Joe Parreira, who served the wine. My friends, thank you and come back. Thank you.
E assim, meus amigos, estivemos com um programa na língua inglesa, mas, portanto, sobre a nossa presença portuguesa aqui no centro da Califórnia. Há, de facto, muitas coisas bonitas a acontecer nas nossas comunidades. Ainda bem que as segundas, terceiras e sucessivas gerações continuam ligados à nossa cultura. E com esta inovação, com esta presença dentro da Universidade Estadual da Califórnia em Fresno, portanto, a nossa cultura estará presente ainda mais. Não só com aulas de língua e cultura, mas também com aulas nas outras faculdades que têm a ver com a nossa experiência, com a nossa presença na Califórnia, nos Estados Unidos e também a riqueza das culturas do mundo lusófono. Foi com muito gosto que estivemos na vossa companhia e foi com muito gosto que vos apresentamos este programa e falando de tudo de bom que está a acontecer na nossa comunidade aqui no centro da Califórnia e particularmente na Universidade Estadual da Califórnia em Fresno. Um obrigado à FLAD, um obrigado à Universidade e um obrigado também à Lúcia Noia. Um abraço e até sempre.